fine signing, I suspect, as a goal kicker, because that kickoff went straight down the middle.
He found grass, that's the main thing. And he was expecting no more than a lob wedge for Rory McIlroy. Big supporter of Ulster Rugby, and he's thrilled to be here, and I'm sure the Ulster players are all delighted to see him on the field and his support.
Having won the FedEx Cup, he could afford to buy Bordeaux and all the vineyards as well.
I think it'd be a Grand Cru Classé, wouldn't it?
Well, there he is, Ian Madigan, signed for Bordeaux this season. Joe Schmidt has been keeping in touch. He certainly is not the forgotten man of Irish rugby, that's for sure. And Joe Schmidt has made sure of that. Ulster playing in their special edition European jerseys, and that's Luke Marshall wearing 13 with a clearing kick, former right half himself, so putting in clearing kicks should be of no issue to him. Lots of changes though yet again in this Ulster backline.
I talked before the game about the number of changes in the backline that bound to affect fluency both sides of the ball.
Came on, May Nadier is in at hooker today, and that is Jan Lesgeurs, who was for so many years the understudy to Dimitri Yachvili at Biarritz. And that is a great drive straight away by Jean-André Murray, who had a good European campaign last season, and he's a superb bullocking carrier. But Ulster have got their hands on the ball here, and let's see if they will use the width of this pitch. 74 metres we reckon it is across. Myself and Mr. Evans paced it before kickoff.
And neither of us have the longest legs, mind.
Good defence by Bordeaux, and here is Ruan Pienaar. Oh, not a great pass though for Paddy Jackson, put under pressure straight away, and he's caught and scragged by Hugh Chalmers.
Use it, please.
So Ulster just taking a second or two to settle into their stride and rhythm.
It's a great atmosphere in the stadium.
Yes, the best supported side in Europe. Their average gate is well over 20,000. That's Ruan Pienaar with the kick, and it's Jean-Marcelin Boutin, who started the first five games of the season for Bordeaux in that fullback shirt, signed from Clermont Auvergne. Here's Hugh Chalmers then with the carry. Now Jan Lesgeurs, very quick. Ian Madigan, we all know about the dangers that he can create, and that is Romain Lonca on the outside in midfield. They've got a very lightweight midfield, this Bordeaux side, not the biggest man.
No, you'd have liked to see McCluskey attack that, but it's a good feet. Lonca in particular, very lively customer in midfield. His feet really well. But you expect the bulk of a ball carrying for Bordeaux Begler being Goujon, Marais, who's qualified for France now, and also Poirot. Live wire of a loose head prop with his offloading presence. And that's going to be the main focal point for their carrying game. They do like offloading, they flood the channels. As the guys in the studio was talking, they have to be far more forceful at the game line in terms of the defence, not allow time and space for players like Madigan, opportunity to exploit those wider channels.
Do you think in about 5 years' time France will play their home games in Johannesburg? Ian Madigan, two Heineken Cup wins for Leinster, 800 plus points for the Irish province. And just doing what he did in the blue of Leinster for many seasons, now doing it in this European blue strip for Bordeaux.
He's over an 80% goal kicker, and he's excellent. Anything within his range.
Spent a lot of time in Bordeaux as a kid. His mum and dad used to take him to a campsite in Bordeaux for a decade. His mum's fluent in French, so he's certainly familiar with this environment.
He's made himself very much at home here. He's the marquee signing, much as Adamasi Cooper was last season. Ian Madigan is the big name signing this year.
And cross kicks from Madigan to Adamasi Cooper could be a feature of this game. They have been a feature already in the top 14. Jan Lesgeurs, and he's launched that one a long way downfield, and a little bit of a misjudgment. Here is Paddy Jackson now. Stuart Olding, he's really struggled with injury, a couple of ACL ruptures, but he's put on a bit of bulk, he's back in form. He played for Ireland on that South African tour in the summer.
Yeah. Bordeaux have the breeze at their back, so expect them to use that.
Rodney Ayew's been a good carrier this season. There he is, number three, the tight end. Andrew Trimble, the co-captain of Ulster this season. Good to see him from an Ulster point of view back from injury at last. And Ruan Pienaar clears long and well.
That's an excellent clearance kick from Pienaar. What else they needed. And both sides have very accurate lineouts. Both at the top end of the stats in their respective competitions domestically.
Ulster have managed to win their last four games against French opposition. They beat Oyonnax home and away and Toulouse home and away in the pool last season, but then lost twice to Saracens. Bonus point defeat at home at the Kingspan. Here is Madigan. They like the little dinks, they like the little grubbers, do Bordeaux. You will probably see a lot of that. It's the way they play, it's the way they try to break down defences, get in behind defences. Here is Les Gourges. Now Madigan brings in Dubier. As you say, they might not be the biggest centres on the planet, but their footwork looks fairly dainty so far.
Yeah, pacey. They're quick off the line defensively. They're certainly giving space. Terrific footwork to attack those weaker shoulders. But you look at the stats, they kick the ball a lot, Bordeaux-Berg, but they tend to be a lot of attacking Canes. And sometimes it's a bit of, it gets confused when you look at the stats. They do like to attack the ball, but they attack space. And sometimes they use the boot to do that. Sometimes they use their hands. But they put lots of kicks. And Serrant plays scrum half. A lot of grubbers from him. A lot of chips. A lot of cross-field kicks. Where Adamash Cooper's been the lad recipient of many, quite a few of those, and scored five tries in five games.
And also, unlike quite a few rugby stadiums these days and converted football stadiums, they've got pretty decently sized dead ball areas, in goal areas too, for those grubbers if they do decide to deploy that tactic.
When a pitch is a good 74, 75 yards wide, there's a lot of space out there. It's about creating space, it's about exploiting space. You make the most of it. As long as you're accurate in what you do, it doesn't matter how you do it.
We're surrounded by fungus today, by the way, folks. None of it's coming from Ian Evans, I hasten to add. It's all on the pitch. This pitch has been cutting up really badly during scrum time this season, very similar to the fungus that infected Murrayfield.
French version.
Crouch!
Smells of garlic, does it?
Bind! Sit!
Because I don't think it was the same one. Very difficult for it to travel across.
Well, the nematode worms could have got the Eurostar. It's not impossible. Penalty for Ulster at the scrummage. You can see the pitch already there. It's churning up desperately badly, and that's going to happen all the way through the game. A real problem they have here at the Stade Chaban Delmas. It was in good condition last season, so it's obviously a fairly recent addition, the arrival via Eurostar of the Scottish nematodes.
I think JP Doyle, the crowd, ourselves and the Lewis Barcombe will be hoping there aren't too many scrums in today's game.
Well, we were talking to JP Doyle before the game, and he said, yeah, he understands the problems they have here with the pitch, and he was not going to mess about. He wasn't going to have reset after reset because of the nature of the pitch. He was going to make decisions.
Very decisive there.
Cracking line out, the Ulster line out has worked really well. Here's Paddy Jackson with a very flat cross kick for Craig Gilroy to try and get on the end. Albany wasn't quite going to get there.
Good idea, poor execution. No, got his feet wrong. Not an awful lot, Craig Gilroy, do that. That's when you're a wing, you've got your back to a defender who's coming towards you. With a horrible feeling you're going to be knocked into the stand.
Pretty quick line-out ball, wasn't it, for Madigan to work off, carried by Romain Lonca. Just 13 stone, 3 pounds. There's Ian Madigan. And there is one of those pushes through in behind that Ulster defence. As I said, something that Bordeaux like to use a lot.
If you draw the defenders up and you create that space behind them, that's a well-executed kick. Boutin.
How many?
And also had the extra bonus of forcing Gilroy to kick the ball a touch. And now they have a throw. We know how effective their driving line-out is. Based on Murray and Chalmers.
Jefferson Poirot is a fabulous prospect. He's already played for France. In control of the ball there. Now they use a little switch play, and here's the drive again, and this is powerful stuff from this Bordeaux side. But Ulster have done extremely well on the defensive maul front.
It must come immediately.
Twice, first of all for the initial line out, and then the secondary charge. Good cohesion in defence. Prevent any sort of momentum being gathered by that driving line out. Manage to get it to ground. And that was a good attacking position for Bordeaux. They'd be frustrated at that. Terrific defence by Ulster. It's been a good lively start by Bordeaux. But Ulster kept him to 3 points.
Ruin Pienaar to feed the scrummage, leaving Ulster at the end of the season. After 6 years at the club, controversially, the IRFU applying their succession plan. They want to see more indigenous scrum halves produced to push through into the Irish team.
It works as long as it is a succession.
Find. Set.
There's Gurs asking the referee, can I pick that up, please?
Probably because of the pitch cutting up, no one's prepared to move their feet. They just want to lock until the ball moves back somehow.
Yeah, again, as JP Doyle was saying, when you get a pitch like this, what happens as a referee when you're watching it? That the forwards all end up like sprinters on starting blocks. You know, they can't go anywhere.
Why scrum halves end up putting the ball underneath the second row's feet.
Crouch! Bind! Set!
Bordeaux losing three pool games last season, winning three. Scoring over 100 points in those three games that they won. Games that featured 24 tries. So they can certainly be an exciting and attractive side. That's Stuart Olding. And here is Pienaar. Ulster feeling a lot of pressure and heat on their own line here. And somehow got to give themselves some relief. And the man with the relieving kick is Ruin Pienaar.
That's excellent from Pienaar again. Good distance.
Throw away quickly. Here's Adam Ashley Cooper. Five tries this season and five appearances. As Yian says, he's been in exceptional form. Ian Madigan. And here is Blair Connor. He's been playing well too this season. Les Gourges. Jondre Marais again around the corner using that bulk. The big South African, soon to be French qualified. Now Poirot.
Okay,
13. Here is Les Gourges. And there's an ugly bunch of forwards standing close by Madigan. And that's worked out well for Madigan accidentally. And there's one of those little grubber kicks in behind that Ulster defence. Well read by Jared Payne. Superb fullback. He was utilised there by Joe Schmidt on the South African tour twice in the absence of Rob Carney. Ulster going here through Stuart Olding. Now it's Luke Marshall. There's space there. Ian Madigan is the sweeper. He's dropped back deep. He's played a lot of fullback for Leinster. And he will pump it away, but not out of play, straight to his opposite number. Joe Schmidt will be watching. Jackson versus Madigan. Andrew Trimble, and good defence by Bordeaux in midfield. Pienaar, but last Ulster getting a little bit of possession here. Stuart Olding on the outside of him. It's Sean Reedy, but here they go. Bordeaux on the pace. Is it in the legs of Dubier? Andrew Warwick makes the important tackle. Now there's maybe space wide. Have Ulster got the numbers out there? Here is Boutin. Great tackle by Andrew Trimble. And again they explore that blind side, and it's Les Gourges with the kick through, and he slaps the turf in frustration.
Both these sides are very good in transition. Otherwise counter-attacking, and turnovers happen, they're very good. They get there in support. They work hard to get support the ball carrier, and that's where the danger lies for both sides. Initially terrific defence by Ulster, forced that turnover, but again you've got to hold on to the ball. also enjoy a lot of time on the ball, time of possession in the games. Can't afford to throw 50-50 passes. Well, eventually just a hold out because there are a lot of numbers at wide for Bordeaux. And again, the width of this pitch allows you those wide passes.
First time.
Rory Bass, 97 caps for his country, will be the first Ulsterman to reach 100 test caps if he comes through the November series unscathed. And Adam Ashley Cooper with a rare half error. Did he fumble that one? Certainly the ball is in touch. 116 caps for Australia. Adam Ashley Cooper, 37 tries. What a superb player he has been. Les Kiss and Alan Clark, the Ulster coaching staff, looking on.
Okay, come on, let's get in, boys. Let's get in.
You know both players are wearing 14. That's a tasty encounter. Adam Ashley Cooper up against Andrew Trimble.
Stay there. Stay there.
Pienaar. Paddy Jackson. No, steps well. Good work from Jackson. That's brilliant.
Tripped over.
Offload goes eventually to Ruan Pienaar and now Luke Marshall. To Craig Gilroy, who was in the Pro 12 Green Team last season. Now Luke Marshall again.
Okay, ball's there, good man.
That's going to be a penalty as Ruan Pienaar just bounces the ball off the back of Duvier. The crowd don't like that. Some would say that's gamesmanship. A lot of scrum halves do it, but a lot of scrum halves win penalties doing it.
Yeah, I thought Marshall did really well
don't
here.
Put me in that position.
Not panicking, stayed back in field.
Time off.
That was a lovely break by Paddy Jackson. He's starting to attack that game line far more these days as his confidence is growing and mature as a player.
Well, Paddy Jackson against Glasgow, I remember, did that a couple of times. Real searing breaks. He showed he's not just a kicking, passing out half. He's got gas as well, and he can find a gap and he can go through it.
Well, it's about an outer half maintaining that balance. You've got to be a running threat as well. Otherwise, defences just ignore you and move on. Which creates less space for the people outside, but having that ability to run past or kick is a valuable asset for any young outside half.
Now, quite a long way out on this beautiful warm Bordeaux afternoon. The temperature above 30 degrees. The sun trying to force its way through the clouds, and Paddy Jackson trying to force Ulster into a good attacking position here, and this is their first really decent attacking position of this first quarter.
This is an important one. The crowd are trying to rally. Paddy and Bordeaux trying to rally their team. Maybe there's some empty space here. It's a big crowd
and a noisy one. Rory Best to Ian Henderson at the tail. Pienaar, no, there's a fumble there in contact. Very sloppy from Ulster. Here's Gurs, Madigan, he looks for that kick, and Ian Henderson is up quickly, but Madigan knew there'd been a knock forward and decided to give it a lash.
There's always a danger when you take the ball that flat and try to use your right foot to kick to the left. You're there to be charged down. Henderson putting pressure, not allowing Madigan any space, but there was an advantage being played. That's got to be careful. You have to hold on to the ball. Go through the phases. If you are to tire this Bordeaux side out, you've got to go through the phases.
Talking of Bordeaux, of course, we're in the wine region here. I notice there is a Barnes Bordeaux. I had a taste. Lots of body, but lacking legs.
Not a Grand Cru classic, is it?
It's from the Clemenceau region, if you want to try it. Barnes Bordeaux, I suspect it's called, not Barnes Bordeaux.
Okay, use it.
Bottom heavy
as well, yeah. Les Gurs with a clearance, and a good one too. My goodness, he made a lot of metres there, and it's appreciated by this growing crowd. They do seem to arrive late here.
You spend your free time wisely, man, don't you?
How many, Ulster? Seven, complete. In.
both sides haven't really been able to hold onto the ball long enough to create the sort of openings they would enjoy.
Franco van der Merwe with a take. He's been an exceptional line-out forward for Ulster since he was signed from South Africa. Jared Payne. Now here is Andrew Trimble. Takes on Buta. Back there goes Blair Connor, the Brisbane-born Bordeaux winger. Does well to grasp it. Well, he's been well and truly grasped by that Ulster defence. And grasped in a very effective way to win that maul.
Oh, good net game. But also, I like to see sides attack from first phase. Ball. And defenders are back, bringing in the line out. That ball out wide, give a bit of space. Maji Cooper had stepped in, left space behind Bhutan to come up from 15. But again, that allowed Ulster to make a good 40 yards upfield.
Form up quick, come on. Keep the gap, boys.
Might be able to hear the Ulster fans chanting and singing away. They reckon 600 to 700 have travelled to this game.
Been here since August.
Okay, use it.
It's good scrummage, well controlled by Sean Reedy. And here is Stuart Holding. Good run from him, and there's a chance now. Oh, clean through. Thank you very much, Andrew Trimble. Back in the side and straight back into top form.
That's a beautiful angle by Trimble. Pina once again attack that short side, back against the grain. And Bodo Begler weren't ready defensively. That's a terrific try by Andrew Trimble. And very lazy, see those big gaps defensively. And a lot of players struggling to get back, not reloading quick enough, and that allowed the attack. Pina lifted his head up, he had a look, and a beautifully timed run by Andrew Trimble. So the first or second visit into Bordeaux's 22, and they make the most of it.
A slashing run there from Andrew Trimble. The timing was absolutely perfect. I'm sure Joe Worsley, the Bordeaux defensive coach, and Bordeaux have got very good percentages in terms of the tackles they make and in their defence, will be wondering what exactly happened there.
Well, it's quick play of the ball, and that's what terrifies French teams generally, because that's not how they play in the top 14. Quick play of the ball, defenders can't get back in time, and then a top end attacking player like Trimble is going to take advantage of that.
I'm really looking forward to your in-play time statistics. I know you're saving them up for later. Here is Jared Payne. He's caught a little bit high maybe there by Jefferson Farrow. JP Doyle right there and agrees. And they're away quickly. Ulster here trying to keep that tempo high. Paddy Jackson at scrum half. And now here is Stuart Holding. Lovely little dummy by Stuart Holding. And the tackle is made by Luke Jones, playing out of position in six, normally a second row. Because of those injuries, the ball goes backwards there, does it? Referee originally signalled that it had, and then decides that it has been fumbled forward.
Oh, that was disappointing. There must have been about a 3 to 4 man overlap out there. And once again, Bordeaux Begler slow to realign. Again, acres of space and just a knock on.
Yeah, it was the second fumble, wasn't it? The Paddy Jackson one was the knock on.
But he's our own piano there, taking a quick tap. That's what Ulster want to play. Keep the ball alive, make the defenders work hard to get back in position. There's a lot of space out there.
Do you want to give us your in play time stuff?
No, I forgot to start the watch.
Don't get too angry about small stuff.
No, what about how much in play time there is in top 14 compared to recent Ulster games?
Well, Bodo Begler generally on about 24, 25 minutes ball in play time, whereas the last two games that Ulster have played, Connaught and the Ospreys, have been about 34 to 36 minutes. So that's an extra 50%. You know, that's a lot for a team who aren't used to. And Rafa Ibanez was talking about it in the press prior to this game. That's what he was most afraid of, if the ball was alive that much with the sort of pace of the game. Top 14 teams do, majority of them do struggle to be able to maintain the levels required.
Set. We've been told that Rafael Ibanez, the director of rugby here, is not actually here. He's elsewhere working for television. Can't imagine Richard Cockrell doing that down Leicester way, for example. Here's Madigan up quickly with Craig Gilroy. Les Gurs just caught by Ian Henderson. Brilliant by Henderson. Can he keep hold of the ball? Not quite. And this time it's a high tackle on Blair Connor.
Ian Henderson did really well there. Jan Les Gurs has a little look. You can't afford that against good defences. You can't dwell on the ball for that period of time.
Ian Henderson looking to rediscover his rampaging form. He's been a little bit drifting in and out of games this season, but we all know how fabulous a player Ian Henderson can be when he's really firing. And firing again back at this Bordeaux defence from deep, our Ulster trying to keep the energy really high in this game. That was Jared Payne carrying, now Alan O'Connor, and here is Pienaar to Paddy Jackson. Sean Reedy in possession, capped on that South African tour off the bench in the summer, and Stuart Olding's made a strong start. I mean that literally in terms of the strength of his carrying.
It's a lot of these mini rucks, that's what Ulster want. That's how you keep the pace going.
Bordeaux a mile offside there, not spotted by anybody, in a yellow shirt.
The turnover, let it go Ulster!
And they've turned the ball over here and they're trying to reset quickly. Here is Buta. Buta almost through, and Arnold Connor has to make the tackle, helped by Paddy Jackson. Here's Jan Les Gurs. Jan Les Gurs again. Ian Madigan fizzes one out to Dubier, has already caused this Ulster defence a few issues. And Ulster will be very happy and very relieved to get that penalty.
That's when Bordeaux have looked dangerous. The ball's been turned over or lost in possession. They do look to counter-attack with Boutin, with Ashley Cooper and Blair Connor. They will bring that ball back. They are electrifying on the counter-attack. Really good work. And really best. Who else would you expect at the breakdown?
Boutin can be such a spectacular broken field runner. So we've seen in his seasons at Clermont. Now here in Bordeaux. Dubier's look a little bit tasty with the ball in hand. Might not be the biggest or heaviest, but he's fleet-footed, that's for sure.
Over 15, line
and best to Franco van der Merwe. Ruan Pienaar, Clive Ross. Ulster missing a few back row forwards, Chris Henry amongst them. Now here's Rory Best. Maynadier trying to get it over the ball there and turn it over for Bordeaux. And Ulster turned a lot of ball over last week against Connacht. They didn't get any supporters in to help the ball carrier. Made it quite easy actually for the Connacht defence. Rory Best. And the counter rucking from Bordeaux is pretty powerful and pretty effective as well. Disappointment there for Ulster, and it's Loan Goujon. Haven't seen too many carries from him so far. Goujon, he's been their biggest, most effective carrier this season from number 8. Try scorer Andrew Trimble finds Olding, finds Dubier in his path.
Good tackle, Dubier. It's at the heavy armour, got involved with the breakdown there. Kobias and Poirot.
Jared Payne, was that flat? Was that forward? And yes, another. An unforced error, really, from Ulster there.
They have been a few, but because of the nature of the game they want to play, they will make more turnovers, they will lose the ball. But there was a lesson there for Bordeaux on how to slow down Ulster. Get bodies into the breakdown and use the size of Poirot, Kobias and Mare to really try and prevent that sort of fluency that Ulster enjoy, the quick ball that Ulster would enjoy. Be physical at the breakdown. That's what Bordeaux have done a couple of times now.
I know you've been talking to the Ulster coaching staff and that they, like you, are very aware of that in-play time. Do you think that might be a tactic from Ulster today to keep this tempo and energy as high as they possibly can and try and run the legs off Bordeaux eventually?
Sorry, Jeff.
And the benefit might not materialise until later on in the game. And that accumulation of all the high-speed game they've had to play, or is it a ball in play time, starts to take its toll. You don't always sort of make the most of it until later on in the game. Whether the pitch allows that remains to be seen.
Sorry, mate. Monty Dawn couldn't fix this pitch.
Capability Brown couldn't fix this pitch.
Pitch that's been invaded by a bunch of psychotic gophers, by the looks of it.
Respect the
couloir,
keep the gap, boys. Okay? 6 foot
strong, keep it going. Remember Caddyshack, don't you? The gopher?
I do remember Caddyshack.
Chevy Chase,
Bill Murray.
That's it. Do you know what the collective noun is for gophers?
No.
It's a segue.
Set!
Nurse!
Movement, Oscar.
Free kick, here is Goujon out. Let's see if he gets those bouldering runs of his going here. Madigan to Dubier and Luke Marshall, they're beginning to realise that he's the danger man in midfield so far, so trying to get up quickly on Dubier. Jean-André Marais always gets somewhere, doesn't he?
He's a very good player. All right.
Here's Luke Jones. Remember those injuries in the back row to Louis Madol and Peter Seeley, Luke Braid. So they've had to do a bit of restructuring in that area. But again, they make those meters, don't they? And here's Lesgers and Chalmers and Ulster again. We're up quickly as they had to be. Gilroy, he really kept the pressure on there.
But that's the area where Bordeaux have made good yards.
Just your left arm in the out.
Big bruising ball carriers. The most physical of sight. That's a good tackle by Gilroy to step in on the back rower. Chalmers. Bordeaux need to use Poirot and Marais to carry on Goujon. What a big unit.
They've made a great signing as well at Tighthead this season. Bordeaux and Vadim Kobias, who was in the Premiership Dream Team last season, very effective in his 5-year spell at Sale, the Moldovan.
Another Moldovan of the Ospreys, Dimitri Arhip. What's the collective name for Moldovan props then?
Lesgers, Madigan, those fizz passes, Dubier, they can be very effective, they can also be very dangerous. If they don't work, it can really put your midfield under pressure.
Okay, fine, but knock down on the tackle, knock down on the tackle. No problem.
Unless you saw the value there of Trimble. He reads it so well. He read that pass, and those fizzing flat passes. He'd have played his Madigan enough times to know when that's likely to happen, right to left. He's going to throw those wide flat passes. And if you're a good defender, you always got a chance of either picking it off or taking man and ball.
The collective noun for Moldovan props is bludgeon. A bludgeon of Moldovan. I just looked it up.
Set. You've been thinking about that for 2 minutes. And that's the best you come up with.
You know me, I'm not that quick.
No, no, set.
Yeah, penalty to Ulster again. And they've done okay at scrum time. They're getting the sort of getting the penalty shouts there. Rodney Ayew gets a pat on the back.
Yeah, the ball's in the front row and you went in.
Different player this season, Rodney Ayew, for Ulster. The strength and conditioning boys at Ulster have worked really hard with him, and if you watch him carrying, he really uses the leg drive. If we can get an opportunity to see that later in the game.
Yeah, he's gone well since he's moved across, and there was some significant doubt prior when the move was announced. Was this one going well at Connacht for him? But he really has stepped up to the mark.
Yeah, in the 2000s.
Ulster haven't made the knockout stages since 2014, when they lost to Saracens in Belfast controversially. That's when Jared Payne was sent off after his collision with Alex Good, you might remember. Good ball, really good ball, Rory Best. So off at the tail of those for Ulster. Still going, still maintaining traction, which is the important thing. Now it's there for Pienaar. Looks on that blind side for Paddy Jackson. Now here's Jared Payne, usually such a silky runner with ball in hand. He ghosts past defenders. Now Ian Henderson.
Pienaar will always look to try and attack that short side.
This time they get it to Clive Ross. Latching on Ulster, Rory Best in there. Paddy Jackson for Olding. He's tackled by Lonka. Pienaar again to Rory Best, brought down by Jefferson Farrow. Good tackle by the loose head. Clive Ross, he's tackled by the other prop, Paddy Kovias. Now here's Paddy Jackson trying to create that space. On the outside are Ulster, keeping it tight, battering away, and then moving into those wider spaces on this very wide pitch. Here's Henderson. Played in the second row and back row for Ireland. Olding again with that step. Seeing plenty of the ball, Stuart Olding. Doing some pretty decent things with it too. Here's O'Connor now.
Yeah, trying to find those little creases where defenders are detached from each other.
Franco van der Merwe goes flying into the breakdown off his feet. Jared Payne, and there's Olding. Little mini wraparound deployed by Ulster there. Now it's Craig Gilroy, and it's Andrew Trimble inside. Well, the two wingers there working in harmony. Craig Gilroy drifting across from that left wing.
I'll be disappointed for us, so they created that opportunity. They created the two-on-one. Really good work. Inside pass. And just couldn't quite go to hand. But that's what they do. That patience. Went through those phases. Then they created a little bit of a mismatch. Created an extra man on that short side. Just couldn't quite finish it off.
No, Paddy Jackson was never going to get hold of that one.
And that's what I'll still be striving to do. Hold on to the ball. Be patient. Hold on to the ball and move this defence around the field.
Okay, ready to go?
I saw it as Andre Murray was on that blind side, attacked the second row, just couldn't quite get the ball to hand.
Bordeaux, four home wins out of four in the top 14 this season. Brive, Lyon, Bayonne and Racing, the top 14 champions, have been the victims. Bordeaux winning the last three matches in the top 14, so developing a little bit of momentum, getting themselves on a roll. Under pressure at the back of that scrummage. It's the Scourge.
Derrière le ballon, bleu, bleu derrière. Jouez-le. Derrière le ballon.
Taking their time, being patient, making sure they get the right sort of ball to clear, which they do. Through the Scourge.
They need a big moment as we approach half time. Bordeaux wouldn't want to concede another try. They need to take their time to clear. The pressure's been put on. Henderson and Pienaar are desperate, not allow Bordeaux to get out to this bottom left hand corner.
Take the line. Give a bit.
Joe Worsley, Jacques Brunel. Ex of Italy and Pepignot has been brought in, I think, to help the forwards in the set piece.
Alan O'Connor, line out take, Jackson, Marshall again bringing Trimble into the action. Why wouldn't you? Here's Franco van der Merwe. Stuart Olding, and he has the ball knocked out of his hands through the challenge of Lonka. Now it's Jared Payne. always a danger and a challenge to defences as Jarrod Payne. Paddy Jackson inside.
Attacking on an inside defender.
Just trying to suck these big Montpellier forwards in here. And then maybe find some space on the outside or maybe through the middle through Pienaar. Little bit of extra pace from Pienaar and he definitely would have been there, but Ulster still might make it. A lot of digging and churning going on and then driving. And no try though. No try, there's been a knock on, but how close were Ulster there and how close was Pienaar? It was just a grab of the shirt that stopped him from getting over.
Yeah, just lost the ball. Desperate defending ball for Bordeaux. And Pienaar very alert, identifying that lazy defender. There's a gap there. Didn't quite have the speed to get beyond that and get over the try line. But you can sense the sort of tiredness, the fatigue around the tackle area. There's starting to be gaps. You saw Paddy Jackson to the inside pass earlier on. A bit slow to get back in position. Pienaar also identified it. Intelligent rugby player, spotted it. Wasn't quite able to finish it off.
Andrew Warwick, the player, he just fumbled that ball over the line. Case Jake White is watching. My apologies to him and Montpellier fans. They did win here earlier on in this season. 32 points to 15. Madigan kicked well that day. 4 penalties from Ian Madigan. And his kicking percentages have been very high all season long. They've been high all through his career, to be fair.
They also have denied him any other further opportunities other than that first 3 points. Discipline would have been uppermost in Ulster's mind going into this game, knowing how good Madigan is. Success rate.
Okay, use it.
Good scrummage. Luc Goujon, because it was so good and going forward so quickly, Goujon wasn't actually able to control the ball at the base, and it's actually put Montpellier, Bordeaux under a bit of pressure here. And they've won the penalty as a result of that. Quite a bizarre situation in some respects.
Well, the ball got prevented from going back by a mound of turf.
Yeah.
And Ulster made the most of it. That was a solid scrum from Bordeaux. And they've been penalised because of the pitch. Just before half time, another easy opportunity for Paddy Jackson to build the gap. You see that mound of earth gradually developing, yeah, and couldn't get rolled back.
Hindered by hillocks. Doesn't often happen in rugby. Well, Ulster will be very pleased if this goes over with their first half performance because they absorbed a fair bit of pressure in the early stages from Bordeaux, and look at them now, 10 points to 3 away from home. Remember last season, they won in Oyonnax, they won in Toulouse, so you know they've lost that fear of France, that they had it for many, many years. Then they went to Castres eventually, and broke that duck, as you said to me before the game, to get the Minky off their backs. I do love stealing your lines. Luke Marshall. So Ulster, minute and a half to go to half-time, 10-3 up, and it's all pretty much going to plan.
And they absorb, as you said earlier on, they absorb the pressure, even though Bodo Begler haven't really created a clear-cut try-scoring chance, by the way, stood a driving line-out, haven't really allowed Bodo Begler to create those chances. Played a lot of the game between the 22s.
Lesgourge, Madigan again fires it into midfield to Dubier. He's been one of the most effective attackers for Bordeaux. Here is Boutin. Oh, the dummy's played off. Good tackle by Jarrod Payne in just the right place. Madigan again has to pick up a very loose and scrappy ball. Gets some help on the switch from Dubier. Oh, and then the fumble forward. And Ulster, will they go from deep here on the counter-attack? Well, they just take themselves nice and gently to half-time. Looks like they're going to attack, though. Here's Pienaar. Finds Stuart Olding. Well, lots of space back there. I think it's Loan Gouja who's covering across. Pienaar and Olding are on the chase here. Here is Buta. What's he going to do? He's going to leave his 22. That's what he's going to do. When you do that, you can't kick for touch. And Ulster might benefit here if the ball can stay in play for Luke Marshall. Not quite. But what a frenetic finish to this first half. A first half that Ulster will be very content with. They've scored the only try of it through Andrew Trimble. And they go into the break up the longest tunnel in Europe to recover with a 10-3 lead. Quinlan Foley and Wallace, one of the greatest club back rows in history.
An overwhelming sense of loss and sadness. And cast a cloud over everything going this weekend. A man who firmly believed in a cause, but always had a sense of mischief and a warmth about him. A giant of the game. Really intelligent rugby player.
And as you may have heard at half time, obviously that Rasig Munster game has been rearranged following that tragic news. Here in Bordeaux, it's Rory Best to the tail of that line out to Ian Henderson. Now it's Paddy Jackson. And Luke Marshall carries for Ulster. Ulster leading at half time, Andrew Trimble scoring the only try of that first half, despite the best intentions of this Bordeaux team, who attacked with a certain amount of verve and vigour at times, but the Ulster defence was firm and resolute when it had to be. Here is Rodney Ayew and his ball carrying, as I said, in the first half. It's something to look out for. It's really improved, and now Rory Best, former Ulster captain, not this season. He's handed over the duties to others. Andrew Trimble and Rob Herring now are the joint captains of this Ulster team. Here's Jared Payne to Henderson. We do with a bit of gain line crossing from players like Henderson in the second half. Good Ulster. And now it's Craig Gilroy.
So to yours now.
Pienaar to Jackson. Alan O'Connor. Pete Brown's been playing well for Ulster in that shirt this season. Alan O'Connor getting his chance at a start today. Now it's Jared Payne, and it's a nice little pop ball again, bringing Luke Marshall into the game. Pienaar, Jackson, good hands. Jared Payne. Now here's Stuart Olding. Where's the pace from Olding? He's got support from Paddy Jackson inside. Just couldn't quite be accurate enough with the pass, and now it's Buta away. Gilroy is back there. He's played at fullback. Looking for grass, doesn't find any grass. He finds a man who played on the grass-coloured green of Ireland 30 times, winning his 30th cap on that South African tour off the bench. This is Loan Goujon, over 330 metres of carrying for Bordeaux this season. But again, Ulster have kept him well trapped as a carrier in this game.
Yeah, Sean Reedy did really well.
Here's one of those grubbers, and it's Lunker on the receiving end of it, putting it in himself. Now Chalmers and Ruan Pienaar. Oh, that's a sign of his class. You could almost see him reading that pass from up here in commentary. Here's Madigan now. He gets caught. Andrew Warwick, the crowd say hi. Referee says no. Minadier, one of the players who's getting the ball away and looking for fast hands on the outside. JP Doyle is going to bring play back. Maybe he did in the end feel that it was a little bit high.
Well, the game is starting off end to end. Difficult to hold on the ball, find that killer pass, not quite going to hand. Really enterprising play to begin with. The patience shown by Ulster going through those phases, retaining the ball, creating that mismatch out wide. Couldn't find that finishing pass. And that time, Bodo Begra fell to a similar path. Good tracking back by Ruan Pienaar. Really good hands to create that opening. The extra man. And looking for the pass inside, not quite going to hand. Plenty of red jerseys there. That's exactly what I still want to do. Retain the ball, show some patience, but when the opportunity comes, be clinical.
Madigan, 79 points in the top 14 this season. He's added three tonight to his overall season total. And quite a long way out there, as you can see. good percentage, just short of 80% in his new Bordeaux colours. Found himself getting very frustrated down at Leinster, spent a lot of time on the bench and playing in positions that he maybe particularly didn't want to play, and he obviously wants to get game time as a 10.
Yeah, and I understand the strategic aspect of not allowing overseas based players in the squad, but he's too good to discard. And certainly his goal kicking is too good to discard in the international scene.
And of course, Joe Schmidt, you know, we'll keep a very close eye on the way Madigan's playing in the top 14. You don't discard a player of that quality just because he's playing in France. He'll certainly not be right up there in terms of selection now because of the way Ireland pick their sides. It will be Johnny Sexton, Paddy Jackson, but Madigan, a fine man to call upon if required. It's Vadim Kobias.
Okay, use it.
In goes Goujon, but just stands over the ball, and here is Jan Lesgurs. Now that's one to contest. Blair Connor climbs. Rory Best can't quite control the ball as he goes down on it. And it's Lesgurs again. Here's Madigan. Now it's Goujon. It's all behind the gain line for Murray, and Ulster swarm forward. Lesgurs. Jefferson Poirot. He's very quick for a prop forward. He's got good acceleration, and he showed it there. Had a really good European campaign last season, did Jefferson Poirot. That's when he really made an impact on the French scene and impressing Guy Noves. Lesgurs, Madigan, and Dubier. They know he's a problem child to deal with in midfield, so Ulster will make sure they shut him down quickly in this second half, you would suspect. Boutin gets his offload away well under pressure to Louis Goujon. Tackle from Henderson. Cleared out pretty well though. Now it's Adam Ashley Cooper. Top try scorer for Bordeaux this season. Lesgurs to Boutin. Again, the offload is good to Hugh Chalmers. So they're creeping forwards, nice and patient so far from Bordeaux. This is Ulster's turn to counter ruck this time. Have they done enough?
Yeah, did really well. Isolated play up.
Counter ruck by Ulster, 7 off.
Bordeaux effective, isn't it? And then they threw those channels and they start offloading. That's when they're at their most threatening. Okay, Adam Ashley Cooper fell over. And there's Gouge. And that stunted the momentum which allowed Ulster back into the game.
No.
Blair Connor. Now Lesgurs claiming for the penalty. A little high from Ruan Pienaar. We've got a few high tackles in this game.
Yep.
Yeah, Blair Connor, so good.
All right, slightly the gaps.
Electrifying when he gets an opportunity. As well to close the gap down.
Okay, I'll continue.
Will pick those really acute angles. Blair Connor, very effective at that.
Ross Kane is on for Ulster, wearing number 18. Les Kiss making a change. The 22-year-old from Bangor. Great hopes for Ross Kane getting his chance due to injuries on the tight head side for Ulster. Ian Herbst has been out quite long term. And Ben Cunningham was saying to me before the game, the Ulster manager, that it sometimes takes injuries for young players to get a chance just to see how good they can be at this level. Those chances
tackle
otherwise
slide,
wouldn't come.
Tackle.
Murray takes the line-out ball, and now it's Poirot. Ulster again trying to counter-up, but Bordeaux controlled it this time. Poirot again.
Henderson's putting in a shift of work on that breakdown, being very physical.
Hands behind the offside line, Ulster. Hands behind.
Goujon. Little dart around that fringe. Adam Ashley Cooper's calling for the ball on this left wing. Here goes Murray, one of the big go forward men for Bordeaux. Ulster attempt a strip. And it's at the heart of Ulster at the moment. Now it's Bainadea. They have the advantage. Listen to the crowd now. Tremendous noise. Adam Ashley Cooper again. He's flapping his arms wildly on this left touchline. I suspect at the moment, though, they're going to use the beef. Here's Mainadie.
Two.
Missed out Murray. Now Madigan. And they do go wide as Blair Connor. Can he shift it to Dubie? He can. Good tackle by Jared T. And that tackle had to be made there.
Read that well. It was helped by the fact that Madigan to put that fizzing wide pass in. Patrick turned and faced the touchline. And if you're an outside defender, okay, you read that
over,
pass.
Knock on.
He stepped in really well, playing.
The noise has abated. They're taking a bit of a huff and puff out of that Bordeaux attack and getting their clearance away.
Ironically, Bordeaux can be a little bit different to other French sides. They've gone back to the sort of orthodox traditional in terms of French rugby play. Pick up and go, drive around the fringes, use the big size. And you see Adam Asikupe, he couldn't be more obvious about what he wanted. Now wide kick. He pleading with his team to find him.
Jacques Brunel has made a change, as I said, in the absence of Rafael Ibanez, who's working for television today, which seems a little bit bizarre, but French rugby can be bizarre. And it's Ave. He's a quality hooker. Lee Simone, 24 caps, played in the World Cup. He would be their number one hooker at this club. Mosgurge, Madigan inside was Adam Ashley Cooper, but he wasn't going to get that pass away, was he?
Pollocks there by Andrew Trimble.
My goodness. Two fellow Irish internationals beating the bedevil out of each other.
As the pick up and goes of Poirot. Carry.
Well, that's what they've been doing, isn't it? The start of this second half is going through the centre, using that midfield channel through the big forwards, but losing possession there.
As a response to the first half, right?
See, scrum advantage.
Is that an overcommitment in the breakdown? So they're picking up and using their bulk to get over the game line, and driving downfield.
Always under pressure.
That's a tactical change. Bordeaux losing the second half.
Yes, they're ignoring the width of this very wide pitch, and just it's the central spine at the moment, isn't it, Jan?
Yeah. Great scrums, keep
up. Because I'm still spreading well, they're numbering up well in that backfield. Losing at times a little bit short around the breakdown. And that's what Bordeaux are capitalising on. You can't be two places at once. So
Ulster historically a good record in this competition, winning it in 1999 when they beat Colomiers down at the old Lansdowne Road. And three quarter finals they've played in, and two finals, 99 obviously, and then in 2012 when they were very well beaten by Leinster, that great Leinster side who won a total of three titles. And on the field now, a player who Ian Evans has been very impressed with, Jean-Baptiste Serrin.
He's the Dauphin, he's the heir apparent to the number nine slot for France. He's already got a couple of caps. I think he's a pretty exciting player. He really is. He's got all the skills. Dimitri Ashvili was talking about him prior to the game. How impressed he's been. He's been working on his goal kicking as well. I think he's a real threat for Bordeaux. And if he gets the opportunity, I think he's a star in the making. Just to see how he goes up against Rouen Pina.
Crouch.
So much experience, so much quality. Rouen Pina.
Set.
Now Ross Kane looks a little bit gloomy after that, being penalised on that tight head side.
And Bordeaux will be happy. The pace of the game has settled down. A lot of set pieces. Bordeaux will be happy, as what I said, don't want. They want that pace in the game, they want that tempo, they want that a rhythm in their game. It's what Bordeaux struggled with in the first half.
Yeah, it's becoming a bit more like what we're used to seeing in sort of traditional top 14 games. It's not the way Bordeaux would naturally like to play their game, but a lot of top 14 rugby is that round the corner driving game.
Yeah, well, it's compared to other top 14 sides, it's not what Bordeaux Begler would want to do, but it's all relative compared to Ulster, who play at a far higher tempo, ball in play time and so on. Bordeaux Begler can't cope with that sort of pace.
Second meeting between the sides. Last time was in 1995 when Bordeaux actually won it in Belfast at Ravenhill, 29-15, and off goes Chalmers. Here's Adam Ashley Cooper, hasn't it too much of the ball, was looking for the offload to Baptiste Serrin there, who'd run a very good line. There's a penalty, hands on the floor from Ulster. Serrin's always looking to go quickly there. You could see his instinct was to tap and have a crack, but Boxeys, I think, is going to try and put this one either into the corner or between the posts. He could certainly reach the post from there, Boxeys. He has long range, but it's the corner for Bordeaux.
He's got such a unique and orthodox style, Boxeys, and he's kicking very languid. Obviously, the penalty be conceded. Again, we're going from scrum to penalty to line out. Exactly what Bordeaux Begler would have wanted.
Pete Brown there in the red scrum cap is on, has had an excellent season for Ulster so far, not just in his general play around the field, but turning ball over too. So here is Ave, looks to the front, goes to the front, taken by Chalmers. Ulster showed good defensive work at the mall in the first half. They're going to have to defend this ball very well because they're under real pressure from it, and they've done superbly. I think that's Ian Henderson, who somehow got his hands on the ball in there. Yes, it was Ian Henderson, brilliant from him. Now Boutin.
Henderson's done some really good work at the start of the second half, very robust on the breakdown, and that time really good work defending the driving line once again. It's all great effect in the first half, again maybe in the second half very strong.
Well, you can almost put that 50 metre gain on the penalty that accrued from Henderson's work.
Yeah. And then good clearance and good chase upfield. Plenty of appetite shown. And respond to this second half from Bordeaux Begler. Have been very forceful, very physical in this second half.
Well, Paddy Jackson, long range. I think there might be just a whiff of a breeze behind him, is there, Jan?
Yeah, the breeze. Not Alistair's backs. He's very much at his limit, Paddy Jackson.
Emil Intermac on the bench there. The Black Panther, the famed Black Panther from his Toulouse player. What a centre Intermac was.
Centre on wing. Great athlete, Intermac.
His percentages this season aren't that high, Paddy Jackson. It's only 65% on the Pro 12, but you wouldn't think it on the evidence of that one.
Well, that kick will give him a lot of confidence. That was a lovely strike of the ball. Didn't try and belt it. That's a lovely strike. That's what gives kickers confidence.
So Ulster still in front here, very, very tight, nervy sort of a game.
Yeah, it's become very tight in the second half. First half, it was very loose as a game. Yes, I can hold on to the ball that long. But it's got really tight, and that's as a result of what the game plan Bordeaux Begler brought into the second half.
Four. Did you say four? Fall, sorry.
Yeah, they've certainly shut things down a little bit in the second half of Bordeaux. Murray takes the line-out ball. Serrin out of Boxeys. pick up by Luke Jones. Luke Jones, three times capped by Australia.
Tackle.
Serrin. Poirot forward pass, I think, from the loose head. It was. It was Dubier, the receiver.
No props, madam.
Just guilty of overrunning the pass. He got to allow the opportunity for the passer to catch the ball and receive it. But Murray, again, good, strong defence. Clive Ross, he's put a good shift in. Cheers, cheers. Poirot.
Well, Ulster's defence has certainly improved today. Last week against Connacht, they missed 28 tackles. They looked very, very soft defensively. They gave away 15 penalties. They were outdone by Connacht big style at the breakdown.
I thought they were placid last week. And really as forceful as you need to be, you can't allow to make Connacht that amount of space and time on the ball. And then they can weave their patterns, they get their play. And those were so effective last season. You can't allow the little time and space for a side like Connacht with Adi Lucan, those are the players out wide. The ability of those forwards in the middle of the park to distribute as effectively as they do. You've got to close down the space quicker and be far more aggressive in the collisions. They weren't that last week, but far better at it this week. And Henderson has been really much at the forefront of that, put some really solid hits in.
Ulster winning four of their last five games in France.
Fight.
After it took them so long to win the first one down in Castra.
Okay, use that.
That's a good scrum. Stuart Olding receiving and Paddy Jackson. Now a little bit of space out there for Jared Payne to run into. Now Craig Gilroy, 10 tries last season in the Pro 12. He's really fizzing and fiery in that competition last season. Now Pete Brown carries for Ulster. Gets a bit of help from Sean Reedy. Better ball for Ulster to work with. A little bit high for Luke Marshall. Had to check his run, but shows his strength there.
Yeah, good leg drive.
Craig Gilroy into the space, but into touch.
So many defences, having a line speed is so important in the modern game, but allows you the pullback passes to create that sort of opportunity to go further wide, where you pull defences in and then you attack where they were.
Loose head, no longer
because they've
bitten.
Loose
head, open side.
Allows you to attack. Yeah, give Gilroy a bit of time and space. He hasn't had an awful lot of that today.
And number 8, Louis Blue.
Roger Wilson comes on. Man who's played over 300 professional games of rugby. Roger Wilson, who's the most capped Ulster player of all time, playing his 213th game now for the province.
Reprise to Tom.
Grooves over there. He hasn't had much of an influence in the game. He's had a terrific season to date. Good player, very athletic, very robust, but very little influence in today's game.
Hugh Chalmers takes the line out.
No, let it go, Ulster.
Yeah, Henderson follow the ball in then.
No, you're late on the ball.
He's in a momentum.
Use it.
Taufa Fanua. Another replacement prop forward off the bench. Serrin just trying to give himself a bit of room, and it's as well that he did because Ian Henderson was descending upon him.
Good hang time with that box kick.
Serrin squeals his frustration. He always wants to go quickly. It's his instinct, his DNA.
He developed a terrific rapport with Adamashi Cooper on his wavelength. Always. Serrin makes a break. Ashi Cooper invariably is near him.
Yeah, just 22. He's in the elite French squad for this season. So obviously he's already been heavily identified as the possible future of the nine shirt for France.
He's got a couple of caps already, but he's the most talented scrum half in France.
Bouxis, good flat pass.
Yeah, that's okay.
And it was Lonka who was on the end of that flat pass. Here's Boutin. Now, JP Doyle doesn't like the nature of that tackle, and Luke Marshall shoved out of the way. So I suspect that Well, this will probably go to Graham Hughes for another look. Boutin in possession. Luke Marshall.
There are players leaning to the ground. I have no problem.
Getting underneath them, okay. And twisting them.
And lift the legs of the horizontal. And always asking potentially.
He might have been helped actually because Paddy Jackson almost softened the descent for him.
I think you're going to give him the time here, Rory, aren't you? You're going to give him the time, right? No, it's just a penalty. Come on.
Okay. I think aren't it's a penalty, okay, right.
Yeah, JP Doyle, that's the call. Number just a penalty. Okay. Boxes into the corner, as you say, with that idiosyncratic kicking style of his.
That's an important period in the game as we go into the final 20 minutes. Side capable of the most of good field position.
Away to Murray. Ulster did really well at the last ball. Ian Henderson came in and pinched it. He could do another pilfer here. It's broken up a little bit, but it's still going. Sarah digs it out. Luke Jones goes. Luke Jones is brought down. Pushed off into the arms of Marco Tullin. And is this going to be the moment for Bordeaux? Here's a Vey. Ulster again working really, really hard at that breakdown. And working brilliantly at that breakdown. How many times now have they turned over the ball in critical positions?
I can't see how that ball got lost.
That's it.
Superb clearance from Paddy Jackson, standing in his own dead ball line. You can see how this ball was lost. I don't think that ball is going to go very far away from the breakdown at all. The big forwards to carry the ball.
Delay. Franco van der Merwe is down injured, close to the posts.
He's waiting for the French selection to show us how that ball was lost.
Yeah, the Bordeaux crowd here are now getting very frustrated indeed with what's happening. And certainly Bordeaux have got themselves into extremely good scoring positions. And whether it's been Ulster's tremendous defensive sets or Bordeaux making mistakes in those situations, they've certainly failed to take advantage of the opportunities that they are creating.
And the one that have played on either side really has been taking advantage of the few positions has been that try for Trimble. Other than that, sides have been a bit loose in that area, that 22 area. And show a bit of composure, that ball retention so important.
Ian Madigan sitting beside Tom Palmer, who won the Heineken Cup with Wasps away back in 2007, as did two members of the Bordeaux coaching team, Rafael Ibanez and Joe Worsley, who were on that same side. Franco van der Merwe has recovered. Good news for Ulster as he's just back from injury. Missed the Connacht game. Here's away. Hugh Chalmers yet again in the line-out. Now Tau Fifanua has to be stopped quickly, and Rory Best makes the tackle. Off goes Luke Jones, gets the offload away to Avey. Serra to Chalmers. Roger Wilson, he just gets brushed off the tackle a little bit there, did Roger Wilson. Here's Buxis. Dubier. Lovely with Lonka. That worked well. There's Adam Ashley Cooper. Pete Brown did well, got across the second row forward replacement to make the tackle of A. And again, Roger Wilson just bumped a little bit in that tackle. Got to make sure Ulster maintain this physicality against people like Murray. Reedy goes in this time, doesn't quite bring him down. It's all a bit soaky at the moment from Ulster, just for the last minute or so. Here's Luke Jones once more. Our Bordeaux beginning to tire out this Ulster defence through the sheer weight and power of these forward drives. And there's another one. Again, it's that central spine, isn't it? All the time, straight through the middle. Serrat or Murray. Here is Tau Fifanua. At last they go wider than the cricket pitch they've been operating in. Carried on this time by Cazot. Julien Cazot, the youngster in the second row today. Again, because of those injury problems that Bordeaux have. And now it's a Vey once more. Here is Serrat looking for that dart. Gets caught. Murray carries once more. It's all Bordeaux ball at the moment, isn't it? Luke Jones, tackled by Reedy. Are they going to just keep on hammering and battering? They're going to try and find a bit of width now through Boxes. Here it is, and it's Bouta, and its defence from Ulster is powerful, and just manages to drive Bouta into touch, and they suck that Ulster side in midfield for phase after phase, and then eventually they try to open the trapdoor through that width.
I'm quite sure why they tend to do that. They were making good yardage. It's the big players, the physical players for Bordeaux Beggar that were creating damage in this Ulster defence, and there's no reason to go wide because there's plenty of numbers out there defensively for Ulster. They were making the yardage to go in those one out runners. And they dominated possession in the second half, making it quite pay.
And the Ulster defence looking a little bit sort of hang-doggish at the moment, just hanging on. The tackles not quite as physical as they were previously.
And the Ulster always attempting to tire out Bordeaux Beggar, but because they're only playing between the 15s, one out runners, 10 teams can do this all day. It's what they do. Ulster need to take them out of that comfort zone, but they can't get hold of the ball because Bordeaux Beggar are dominating possession. And there's definitely a sort of shift at half time. The type of rugby they want, they were going to play, the type of rugby that Bordeaux Beggar needed to play, they were to win this game. And they're using the same names all the time. Murray carrying the ball effectively. Luke Jones carrying it. Cazot carrying it.
No.
Big men, and they have a physical advantage in terms of size and stature.
Yeah, it's been a complete reverse in tactics. Second half, Mark Clark is on for Bordeaux. The tight head, he started last week against Brive, the home win against Brive.
It's very difficult to win collisions against Ave and Tau Fifanua.
He's just played on the ice, so he's just getting tight.
Bordeaux go to Clermont next week. You might remember their meeting last season at the Stade Marcel Michelin, the scene of probably the most bizarre and dramatic round 6 pool game in the history of the competition, and it's on Sky. Bordeaux won 37-28 to deny Clermont a place in the quarterfinals. All Morgan Parra had to do, that a penalty under the post in the last couple of minutes, had to kick it. All Clermont acquired was the losing bonus point, and nobody knew they needed that, not even the management.
And in the last 10 minutes, Clermont went from being group winners and having a hope quarter-final to being out of the tournament.
And bottom of the pool.
But it was the fun pool of the tournament last year, and I think similar aspect this year. And we swap Alistair for the Ospreys, and then you have four teams who are capable of playing some breathtaking rugby. We've seen a different type of approach from Bordeaux Beggar in the second half.
But as Jimmy Gamble said before the game, you know, this could be, you know, if it unfolds the way we think it will, the exotic pool of the tournament.
All the sides are capable of beating each other. The more you would still say are the favourites because of the talent they have at their disposal. But the three sides who can beat each other.
Crouch!
that Clermont-Bordeaux game. 8 tries in the match. Bordeaux scoring 17 points in the last 12 minutes to unhinge Clermont.
Okay, use it. Use it, Julian.
Marco Tillane picks up under pressure from Ruan Pienaar. Just a little bit slow to use the ball there was Tillane. But they've got the penalty.
The pitch is certainly not helping Bordeaux in terms of getting the best out of their scrum. It's helping them in other aspects as it's slowing the game down. But in terms of their scrum, they can't make the most of it. Okay. And optimise the benefit of having a strong scrum.
The problem is when this fungus sets in, as they discovered in Scotland at Murrayfield, it's a very difficult thing to get rid of. So they may be stuck with conditions like this, Bordeaux, for the rest of the season. Not good news for Exeter Chiefs and Clermont coming here later on.
19, never released.
I don't think Bordeaux Beggar want to try and take Clermont on in the scrum, Mike.
Fair point.
Yeah, well, that would be easy, wouldn't it?
Away to Chalmers. He's taking a little line-out ball today as Hugh Chalmers. Now there's a lot of muscle in there. A lot of big boys. Our Ulster beginning to tire. They're getting very close here.
One
more pick up and go might be enough. That is Sarah. They go around the blind side. Sarah actually threw a dummy pass in there. And here's the roll around. Tau Fifanua is in there. Ulster are using up a huge amount of energy in this second half in defence. But they are still defending well. Ian Henderson. Two tacklers in there for Ulster. He was one of them. On the starting blocks. And it's Avey who is there. Have Ulster got underneath him? JP Doyle gets out the microscope and decides that the ball has been held up.
JP Doyle makes the call, doesn't go to the TMO. He's right in the correct place to make that decision.
Alright, you Tom.
Now this is more questionable. Character for Ulster more than anything else. It's not exactly an organisational thing. It's showing the heart to commit, get back on your feet, get back in position, ready for the next hit up. You know where it's going. There's not an awful lot of subtlety or subterfuge involved.
No, it's been long periods in the second half. Cocooned inside their own half of the field.
Let's go, guys! Spent over 4 minutes in the 22.
Fight!
No!
Sit!
One-handed feed from Sarah.
Use it!
Tillane picks up. Good tackle by Henderson. He's put a lot of defensive work in this second half. Tillane has it again, though, for Bordeaux.
It's a tackle!
Sarah. Tau Fifanua, in comes Rory Best. Sarah again, and they look for another big man to pop the ball off to. Look at Ulster's counter rocking there. You talk about the heart, but it's Murray who has it. Drives into Paddy Jackson. Pete Brown brings him down. Here is Sarah now, and it's Lionel Boxis. Oh, and it's Dubier who knocks the ball on under pressure from an heroic tackle from Luke Marshall.
That's what it's going to require, a commitment to
Come
the
on,
cause.
Oh, yeah,
that's just an error. That's an enforced error, actually.
I actually thought it was the influence of Luke Marshall, but Duvier had made the error before Marshall really got on top of him.
And Boxey's attacking a little crease in the defensive line, looking for the offload. Took the ball all the way to the game line.
You need to explain the rules to Andrew.
The supporters in good voice.
No, no,
urging the team to keep showing that heart and commitment.
Well, the Ulster symbol's the red hand. As you say, it's all about the heart in this last 8.5 minutes of the game.
There's a lot of tackles they're having to make, and that does take its toll. They're going to run an awful lot of distance, but it does take its toll when the big players keep charging away.
Bordeaux pitch their 10 to the 22. Roger Wilson, number 8. Oh, that's difficult, very difficult. Here's Paddy Jackson. Oh, he's under pressure. Three Bordeaux defenders. All they got to do now is catch and flop over and maintain control. Ulster getting themselves into all sorts of trouble there. Off goes Sarah Pete Brown. Good tackle round the corner. Super defence from the replacement.
Okay, advantage penalty, Ozil.
Awful exit strategy from Ulster, and it could cost them. There's a penalty coming the way of Bordeaux, and it's Boxeys into the corner. Up there goes Blair Connor. Craig Gilroy can test for the ball.
Offside at the ruck.
Offside at the ruck, though, and JP Doyle brings them back for that penalty. Well, what were Ulster doing there? They just had to clear the lines. They could, but it took two or three of them to make an attempt to clear it. None of them could.
Well, all because of the pass in the back of that scrum. Really shoddy. After putting so much effort in order to create an opportunity to clear the lines, he said, relieve the pressure. An error just makes the pressure come back on again.
On comes Tom Palmer. He's 37 years of age now, but he does have the experience of winning this very competition in the Lawrence Dallaglio Wasps days. That 07 final, Danny Cipriani, as a youngster, was playing fullback.
Well, this is defensive work around the line has been good so far in the game.
Straight back down.
It's another opportunity now for Bodo Begler. As he posts the final 7.5 minutes or so of the game, take advantage. As you said, they've been encamped in Ulster's 22 for the best part of 5 minutes or so of this.
11 or 14. Yeah.
Adam Ashley Cooper is off, and here's an attacking force coming on in Matthew Talibula. The backs as an attacking force haven't seen a huge amount of the ball in the second half.
Hold on.
It's been a bit of a monster munch from Bordeaux in this second period. Will it be Hugh Chalmers again? He's at the front of the line out. It is, isn't it always?
Inside five, line
so another maul for Ulster to defend here. Taufifanua, blind away towards that corner flag. The crowd have erupted because they think that Taufifanua has done enough to get the ball onto the ground before he hit that touchline.
Immense strength.
Try yes or no, please.
Just to see where he did manage to ground it before he went over the touchline. He did really well, forcing it towards the touchline. Plenty of numbers there, but sheer strength and size of Taufifanua. Pulled in Rory Best, and that left Andy Trimble trying to defend the sheer mass of Taufifanua. And from that angle, he certainly grounded it. I don't know whether he had his foot in touch or not. No, that's a try. That's immense strength.
Talk to me, Uzi.
Okay, JP, you may award the try.
Three men couldn't bring him down there.
Well, they've deployed the Big Bang Theory all through this second half, and in the end, it was the Big Bang Theory that paid off.
Sheer size and strength. They've really brought Bodo Begler back into this game, and now in charge as we approach the final 5 minutes or so. He's taking his toll on Ulster.
Yeah, it looks like a pretty exhausted Ulster side, and this will add a little bit more pain if Boxeys can convert. He can't. but have Ulster got the wherewithal, and that word again, the energy to get themselves back down there and get the points that they need.
Well, that's the thing, get down there. How many able to, it's no territory, very little possession. They had one opportunity to clear the lines, and they didn't. An error, lack of communication in the back of that scrum. And Bodo Begler could put the pressure on once again, but they need to spend some time in Bodo Begler's half. Really get some ball and really try and turn that pressure around.
Of course, the points they need are of any description. Here's Talibula. Oh, there's space here for Talibula. Chalmers in support. Talibula is away here, and Talibula could finish off Ulster. Talibula inside for the support. And what a breakout that was by Bordeaux. Baptiste Serra was the player who was on the shoulder. But Talibula, sensational with ball in hand. A searing break from him.
I don't believe a try has been scored.
Okay.
But we'll check try yes or no. I'll also check for an early tackle on the 21.
It was an early tackle. JP Doyle doesn't think the try was scored. Breathtaking.
So I need that at real
from
speed.
Talibula looking for the inside. Yeah, hands were on.
She's checking the grounding first.
Yeah.
Sean Reedy puts hands.
There's no grounding, but do you ask the question here?
We're just looking out the tackle.
Would a try have been scored
when you take the last defender out?
Because in ultra slow-mo, he can't really tell. So I need to see that at real speed.
Yeah, it's coming out.
But a lack of concentration of that restart allowed Talibula to get downfield. And if it wasn't for that tackle,
Andrew, I'm working here. Thank you.
So whether there was enough of a contact on Serra
influence
it.
We just need to talk through this.
Yeah.
I believe there is early contact by the number eight.
Yes, I agree.
Okay. That contact, unless you can think otherwise, the probability is that guy catches the ball and would score.
Yes.
The early contact lets him tackle him, which stops him grounding the ball.
Yes.
Okay?
I agree with you.
Okay, that's what we got.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's it's a number eight, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, number eight. No, hold on, Andrew. Eight. What we have, we can see it on the screen. You've made contact early and you've tackled him. That has stopped him grounding the ball. Therefore, it is a penalty try and you have to be yellow carded, okay?
We are talking split second, but he certainly made contact. And you take the last defender out, which was Sean Reedy, and that had an effect on Serran's ability to finish that. But a breathtaking counter attack from Bodo Begler up from Talibula, and certainly the bench have made a difference for Bodo Begler in terms of bringing those heavy forwards into the game and also having Serra and Talibula on the field. Great counter attack. A lack of concentration in the restart allowed Talibula to gather the ball, make great yardage downfield, and Serra follows the player making the break, always getting his shoulder. You never know what's going to happen. And unfortunately for Sean Reedy, who's worked really hard, but there was an early contact prior before he managed to gather the ball. So,
well, Ulster exhausted, pummeled in this second half, battered and battered and battered by carry after carry from those big forwards, and then two tries in very quick succession for this Bordeaux side have killed off Ulster.
And it's the type of game that Bodo Begler are employing in the second half that caused the fatigue in Ulster. It was a similar game to the first half, very loose, very fluid, and Ulster are more than capable of withstanding that, but heavy brigade taking their toll.
It's hard to see Ulster couldn't get a converted try and a penalty or a drop goal in the last 4 minutes. If you look at how this game has been unfolding since half time,
they just need to get the ball in the opposition half and try and get anything.
Side, off feet, side, 11.
Well, about as we see Lionel Boxeas's conversion to penalty from the penalty try, Bordeaux making several infringements at that breakdown. JP Doyle identifying two of them, so Ulster do get a chance at least to get the territory they're desperate for.
And they want to get a losing bonus point out of this game. And they're 8 points away, they just need to get a bonus point. But Bodo Begley have turned this game on his head in the second half. And it looks like they're going to make any leeway at all for the back line. They lose that heavy brigade up front. They're dragging them back into this game.
Line-out's over.
Ian Henderson's taken the line-out. Paul Marshall is on. Paddy Jackson, the holding, another little wraparound. We've seen that before in this game. Here's Jared Payne. Can he get outside Blair Connor? Great tackle by the Australian-born winger. Marshall to Best. Just never know. If Ulster can get a try right now and convert it, they could still win this game. Big ask. Marshall. Rob Herring, the co-captain of this Ulster side this season. Marshall to Luke Marshall. Now Pete Brown carries into the final 2 minutes. Marshall to Marshall again. Paul to Luke. Ulster have found some gas from somewhere. Paul Marshall once more, and Rob Herring in possession. Marshall gets it away to Pete Brown. Hugh Chalmers, the line-out king, makes the tackle there. That's Paddy Jackson. Bordeaux's turn to defend. They haven't had a huge amount of it to do in this second half. Pete Brown tackled by Tom Palmer. 37, but still going, and Paul Marshall is tackled by Mark Clark there without the ball. Off goes Paul Marshall. He's good at this, is Paul Marshall. Roger Wilson now. Closing in the final minute. They got to act fast here. Here's Trimble, and the ball is knocked from his grasp. Lionel Boxeace picks up. Now it's Boutin. Boutin could be away here. Blair Connor, has he got the pace for the clean run? To the try line he has. In the end, it's a boardwalk for Bordeaux.
I don't get why the tap penalty. Why the tap penalty? 3 points would have brought a bonus point. Would have brought a bonus point try. Bonus point. A losing bonus point. And they weren't able to do it. They turned the ball over. And Blair Connor goes away length of the field. You need to make sure you have your wits about you when you get to the back end of a game. You take the 3 points, you move away with a loss, but a losing bonus point instead. They tried attack and scored a try where a try wasn't necessary. You just needed the 3 points, and then Blair Connor gets away. He's his gas. Gallops up the field. Be heartbreak for Ulster. That'll be really frustrating. At a period with on the ball, after defending for so long in the second half, huge period of defending, an opportunity to get a penalty and close within 7 points, and they didn't do so.
So it's Bordeaux's victory in the end. They started their European campaign with a home success in this Stade Chaban Delmas fortress of theirs. Comfortable in the end. First half, Ulster played very well. They took that lead. But Bordeaux simply bombarded Ulster in that second half to come away with a comfortable victory. It's Jean-Marcel Boutin who's been nominated as the man of the match. But this day of rugby will be dominated by the tragic news breaking today that overnight Anthony Foley passed away before the Racing Metro Munster game. That game has been postponed and rearranged. So certainly a somber mood enveloping the rugby family across Europe this afternoon.